First of all, good afternoon. Laurent Pinsard speaking, IASA Structure Senior Expert. So first, I would like to remind you what has been presented to you by David this morning. This nice, I don't know, the future vision of safety aviation or rotorcraft aviation. And I don't know if you have seen this morning, but you can see as a priority that fuel tank protection and seats were identified in this plan. So I think we are talking about occupant protection. And it's also a good, the presentation before was, a good transition to discuss or to address this topic. We have seen how it is difficult to comply with a drop test. Drop test, fuel tank drop test is probably the pillar for for occupant protection. It's one, it's first mandatory test, but it's offer a significant protection for the occupant and a very visible protection. So how it works next. So yes, again, the presentation will be shared with Martin Crane from FAA. This is the content of a presentation. So first I will just remind what is the fuel tank crash requirement. The requirement related to seat and structure. Then we will go quickly to the status of a European or US fleet to give you a general overview of the problem when you try to identify how the population is made. I will tell you the IASA objective, which are also there, and the AWAC occupant protection working group activities, and also the final result, which has been published and submitted already and accepted. And then I will give you a conclusion, the IASA position, what we try to do. I just want to remind you also that at the 10th symposium, at IASA 10th symposium, we did this presentation, but it was the beginning of the start of these activities. So today we have spent nearly 2 years to think about this topic and to try to find the proper manner to go for an improvement of occupant protection. And of course, a conclusion. And we will move to the presentation from the FAA on this on the latest progress made. Okay, so fuel tank crash protection. What you have seen before, the drop test, the fuel tank blader, is again one test which is requested by the 952 CS29 or 27. I don't know if you have identified, but you can see that at some point you have seen only blader tested, and sometime it was also with a full structure tested. So today, what is requested is to test the blader with the necessary adjacent structure. And so this is addressed in the 952, fuel tank crash worthiness resistance, the drop test, which include also lots of, additional protection, like breakaway fitting, or some puncture test to validate the resistance of the blader itself against puncture. And there is also one additional requirement related to a static ultimate test, which is addressed in the 952B. So all this package together give you try to prevent a fire in case of crash. A survivable crash. There is no need to protect against a non-survivable crash. Oh, there is a need, but okay. And then we have the other, I mentioned pillar for fuel tank. There is another pillar, which is seat and structure protection. And again, the objective is to prevent or to minimize injury, again, in the case of survivable crash. And the objective is first, the seat remain attached, so no detachment of the seat. The occupant remain on the seat. And we have added some anthropomorphic criteria, like a spinal injury or loads, the loads on the belt, So we have a list of head injury criteria. We have a list of criteria which are quite challenging to succeed or to comply with, which is addressed in the 562 and also the 785. So it requests two tests, a vertical test and an horizontal test at a quite high G load level. On the top of this, or of that, we have also the 561, which requests a static compliance for any item in the helicopter, and also for the seat itself. So seat, static dynamic test, and item of mass, static test, or static compliance demonstration. So these two elements are the pillar for occupant protection at EASA level. So the situation, why we are here still discussing this topic? This topic has been addressed in, I will say, more than 20 years ago, and has been addressed properly in the rule. Means if you look at the revision of the rule, it has been done a long time ago, and we can consider that probably lots of aircraft has implemented this compliance with the latest requirement. This is not the case at all. In fact, when the topic has been the requirement has been revised to introduce the latest, the most updated occupant protection requirement. For derivative product, in general, the latest requirement has not been implemented just because it was not considered, for example, fuel tank installation or seat installation was not considered as a significant change locally for the certification or for the validation. And we have also all the fleet which has not been shown compliance because the certification, the requirement was not there. So at the end, we have a population of aircraft produced and certified after, I will say, 2000 and even 1994, which are still not compliant. And we have, of course, the latest certified aircraft which are compliant. So we have a population of non-compliant and compliant. And all these situations result in a low incorporation of the latest occupant protection requirement in the rotorcraft fleet. And what we can see in the statistical data is that the number of fatal accidents remain very high when it should have been reduced. But again, the population of non-compliant aircraft is still remain quite high. And I can give you some examples. So please take it carefully because some aircraft today has the opportunity or the possibility to be compliant with. It means STCs or something has been implemented. Another point also which is not mentioned is this aircraft which has been certified and or validated and validated are flying. Sometimes they have incorporated STCs, means modification which can, I will say, impact the compliance with this requirement. And I'm not 100% sure that all these STCs or change has incorporated also the latest, or has considered the latest requirement for the occupant protection. So in total, it makes that we have a population, a very, we'll say, heterogeneous population, which does not offer the same level of safety or occupant of protection level. Okay. So here I try just to summarize the situation, but the situation is far more complex. First, you have non-compliance, fully compliance, partial compliance. And the pie I show you here is not correct, in fact, because fully compliance, you have only a small portion which are fully compliant. The other partially compliant, it's probably correct, but you can share more fully compliance and non-compliance, means you, this is, this graph is not correct, in fact. We are not in this situation. On the top of that, you have to consider that we have CS-27 aircraft and CS-29 aircraft. So are we going to make some, if we think about to recover this situation, are we going to make some consideration about the fact that we have a large rotorcraft or small aircraft, small rotorcraft? So again, this picture is, as shown here, is just an illustration, but is not correct. And again, on the top of that, you have all the STCs, the modification which has been implemented, EMS installation with new seat. Does the seat are systematic compliance with? I cannot tell you that it is correct systematically. Okay, so based on this nice picture, the objective for EASA is to try to implement fully or partially the latest occupant protection requirement. And this has to be done on the existing service fleet and for any future manufacturing type design, all type design, having not incorporated the latest occupant protection. So the objective is, I will say, clear. Then the problem is how to make it, how to declare what is an acceptable level of occupant protection compared to the latest standard. This is another challenge. And we have for that at the end, when the process will be completed, we will have either the AD or the Part 26. The AD offers us the opportunity to do it quite quickly, means we can decide tomorrow to publish an AD saying, we do not want to have aircraft operating without having incorporated the partial compliance or full compliance with the requirement. Part 26 will be a rulemaking activity. It will take years, and it's, I will say, it's a longer process. So we have to think about what will be the most appropriate, way or approach to recover the situation. So we are lucky because at the same time of the beginning of the rulemaking activity, we have also the AWACS activities, which started in 2015, 16, I don't remember exactly, with the objective to address this issue for the newly manufactured rotorcraft and for the existing rotorcraft fleet. And the topic or the objective for this group, so this group is made of industry plus association, organization, and I will say anybody which are more or less involved in the rotorcraft activities, operators also. And the target given to this group was to improve or to propose improvement or adaptation to the existing occupant protection or any new alternative performance-based, like operational limitation or any consideration which can be suitable for to address this, to recover this situation. So just briefly, I will summarize the activity. The activity was shared with, or was split in task 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. From 1 to 5, it was to address the newly manufactured rotorcraft. The task 1 and 2 was the evaluation of the efficiency, means the cost benefit of the existing requirement. So we look backward to the 10 years experience of rotorcraft having full compliance or partial compliance. And we try with, on the statistical basis, we try to identify what has been the benefit to have the requirement, the latest requirement, the full requirement implemented. The task 3 is to propose an implementation of partial compliance or alternative performance-based occupant. Task 4 and 5, 5 is the final presentation of a conclusion of task 3, 4, and 5. The task 4 is to evaluate or try to evaluate the cost-benefit analysis if alternative performance base is proposed. And of course, we have also the task 6, which address the recommendation for the aircraft under production, or the aircraft, the existing fleet of rotorcraft, meaning the aircraft which are flying today, recommendation on how to improve crash safety of the existing fleet of rotorcraft. Means you have a population of aircraft flying today, and you have to propose some solution to recover a better occupant protection level. Newly manufactured rotorcraft, task 1 and 2, it's just to develop a 10 years cost benefit, as I mentioned before. What has been shown, and I briefly summarize the conclusion of this final report, is fuel tank occupant protection 952, even partially, means instead of to test the full blader and adjacent structure as we have seen on the nice movie before. We have seen, or the numbers, the statistical data show us that having the blader already drop tested and validated through the drop test offer to the offer an occupant level of protection quite interesting. And the order, for example, is if we consider that without the blader installed, means without any fuel tank protection, we will reach about, I would say, more than 10% post-crash fire without any, we'll say, fuel tank protection. With complete protection, we reach close to zero, means no post-crash fire in a survivable crash. And if you incorporate a blader which is only tested without the surrounding structure, means demonstrated with a blader only, you will reach 1% about. Again, it's only statistical data. But it shows that even with a partial compliance, you will not reach the level of full compliance, but it's a reasonable level which is offered to the operators. The situation has been more complex for 5.6.1, means the seat test, the protection inside the cabin. It has been very difficult for the group to try to establish or to use some statistical data, just because when we look back at the investigation report, there is limited information on the situation, the scenario of a crash, or the scenario of a crash, yes, is investigated to determine the reason of a crash. But they do not offer a clear or good picture about the injury of the occupant, the condition within the cabin. And this has really limited the investigation which was possible to perform as for the post-crash fire condition. So it was more challenging for seat occupant protection. But what is clear is in the report, they say there is a benefit. And also to remind you that the benefit at the time of the implementation of the seat protection was estimated to 30%, 30%. And I think the number is still valid. And yes, so this is one part of the conclusion of the our group, of the task one and two. Lack of impact condition on occupant protection in the accident investigation render occupant protection analysis difficult, and also difficult to provide a conclusion on this matter. Task three is still on the newly manufactured rotorcraft recommendation on how all or part of 5.6.1, 5.6.2, 9.52 should be made effective, or to propose new alternative performance base. So adaptation of a CS, or of a FAR, I should have said, or any alternative, like operational rule, or promotion of some, okay. There is one point also which was addressed in the task number three, is about, do we need a transition period for full occupant protection requirement implementation on newly manufactured rotorcraft? This is an interesting point, is if you request to be full compliance tomorrow, it will be really a severe, I will say not penalty because it's a benefit, but a severe challenge for the applicant or the operators or for the applicant here because it's newly manufactured. It will be a real challenge to incorporate the full compliance. So what was proposed is it necessary to introduce a 10-year transition period? Means you are first, you start to produce newly manufactured aircraft with a partial compliance, and later on, means 10 years after this transition, you are full compliance. I'm not too, confident with this option. Means 10 years. If you stay with 10 years in this situation, first your aircraft is, if the aircraft, how to say that? If you think that this transition is valid for 10 years, and if you have incorporated, I will say, a partial compliance with the requirement, why after 10 years, the day after, you think that you have to incorporate an update or an update of your installation? And this has been about the conclusion of the group, means to say there is potentially, or it is not recommended to have this transition period. We will propose, and the group has proposed, some partial compliance with the requirement, but without the 10-year transition. Cost-benefit analysis, if alternative performance-based occupant protection safety regulation effective are proposed. This is for the tasks 4 and 5. And 5 gives you the final report for the task 5. It gives you the full picture for newly manufactured rotorcraft. And of course, for the task number 6, we have exactly the same process, but for the existing rotorcraft fleet, means the objective was incorporating rotorcraft occupant protection improvement, but of course, it was for the existing rotorcraft fleet. And here, it's another challenge because the configuration of the aircraft is probably more difficult to determine. The number of aircraft also could be challenging. It is also done at the operator level in this case, hein, because you address this problem to aircraft which are in service. So there is probably far more constraints. And these constraints has to be considered for the implementation of any new requirement or new rule. And we can think also one aspect which has to be considered also. And I think in terms of, we can also introduce some priority in this kind of update of the fleet. Hein? We can consider that the aircraft which has been certified after 1995 and which has a benefit of the derivative product process, means which didn't incorporate the latest requirement, could be eligible, I will say, first compared to the other which has been produced 10 years before the latest requirement. So we can also, I will say, adapt the implementation of the improvement to the fleet. Task 6 is quite interesting. There is, of course, in the recommendation done by the group, the implementation of a current occupant protection regulation means do you apply the full or partial compliance? There is also some interesting, I would say, discussion or proposal related to educational or incentive programs to be developed. There is consideration of industry standard. Also personal protective equipment used for certain missions, and a change to enhance improve occupant protection regulation. And also there is some proposal to make some research on this topic. Okay, I'll just give you the latest status of the IARAC recommendation, which has been submitted, huh? So it's and I give you also the EASA position in this. So the first priority is fuel tank blader. As you have seen before, to test the blader alone has been found quite beneficial for the occupant protection. And the group considers that it has to be implemented, means the blader has to be installed or and tested alone if possible, or if... You can also perform with the adjacent structure, but it will not be requested. There is also one consideration for the 250-pound puncture. This is a reduction compared to the existing rule today. Today, we have 370-pound puncture test. With this rule, in fact, it is just to adapt, I will say, or to make the adaptation to an update of the of a protection, and to not force the operators or the owner of this rotorcraft to change just because of this criteria. The 250 pounds criteria was probably there before the 370, and it is considered that if we request 370, it will make a significant, I will say, retrofit or lots of activities for the operators. So I will say that we support this proposal to limit and to propose a partial compliance for 952 with some limits. It means that if we have evidence that the surrounding structure can puncture systematically the blader or can damage the blader, I think we will have some consideration about the risk of some design which cannot be ignored by us. The second point is about the upper torso shoulder harness to be installed on all rotorcraft. This is again for existing fleet. For newly manufactured rotorcraft, what has been proposed is a partial or full compliance with 562, means the dynamic test. So here we do consider that it's a, we remain at a quite a low level. The proposal is not really challenging here for at my level. We do consider that it should be, it is a good starting point, but it should be probably updated. So if we have a rulemaking activity, probably EASA will promote something a little bit more demanding in terms of compliance. But it is, of course, it is supported, but the proposal is not as expected in terms of the level of proposal. And there is one which is, I will say, of a limited impact, but I think it's a good point. It's to protect any range of population, means from child to adult, to protect any occupant in the rotorcraft. When you are doing some tour and with your child or whatever, there is no, I will say, no reason to not offer to your child or to the same level of protection as for the adult. So it's a good point. Of course, in terms of numbers, quantity, it will be limited, but psychologically, I think it could be quite beneficial to have this. So as I mentioned, this is the position already provided to you. Fuel tank blader crash resistance, fully supported, strongly reported, strongly supported by EASA. But again, we will discuss about the 952A4, which requests the installation of a surrounding structure. And again, if we have evidence that the surrounding structure can damage the blader, we will not ignore it. It's finished. Completely or 20 minutes? Or? Okay. Just the what I mentioned here is about the long process with a 10-year transition period. And I think this process, as it is implemented today, is probably too long. This is the EASA conclusion. We have an EASA rulemaking which can start at any time. We support the partial compliance if demonstrated efficient and can provide an accept, and this provide an acceptable approach. Operational limitation or alternative recommendation has to be considered by EASA and FAA. And implementation time, long process, I think we will not wait for 3 or 10 years before having something. And of course, what is very important is we expect a convergence between EASA and FAA. Is it possible to have 5 minutes? Or?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
How long do I have? 10 minutes?
Okay.
10 minutes, okay.
I'll speed through this. So now let me get into how the FAA has accepted this and then also talk about a recent congressional mandate and what that means for the industry. My passion is truly aircraft seats and structures, so I'm gonna spend the next 10 minutes talking about fuel systems. So the FAA plan going forward, we're reviewing these reports. These reports are one of the big pieces of information we use in the rulemaking process. It gives us a really good understanding of, a really good understanding of where industry is coming from, where their concerns are, what they, you know, the costs and complexity of installations and all. But it, you know, we'll do our own research, we'll do our own evaluations, our own cost-benefit analysis. But we truly, the Rotorcraft Standards Branch, which is the office I'm in, has every intention of putting this into fiscal year 2020 rulemaking. It's a multi-year process, like he showed. He's, you know, showing, you know, 5 years in the future for a rule, and then an implementation date after that. And once again, we have every intention also of coordinating and harmonizing with EASA. I wouldn't say completely in line, but we have a very similar understanding of the report and have taken a lot of the same reactions to the report as EASA has. One of the things we're doing is a lot of outreach with policy statements. We haven't written policy statements. What we have done is SAIB's Special Air Witness Information Bulletins, one of which got modified just yesterday. But let me go into that. For future rulemaking, similar to EASA, we can use 27.2 and 29.2 as special retroactive requirements. As he said, we used that in 1993 to mandate shoulder harnesses for all new manufacturing. Once again, 27 rules apply to an application today. So we can say anything after today has to be produced with something. The question is, how do you do it for the existing fleet? You can do it through operating rules. You can say no one can operate an aircraft without a 29.562 compliant seat after 2030. But do you do that for everybody? Part 91, Part 135, Part 136. The other option is to use Part 26. Unfortunately for the FAA, Part 26, unlike CS 26, is written specifically for transport airplanes and in the transportation system. So EASA, I'll throw you one here, did it properly, and they can use CS 26 for rotorcraft, 23, 25, 27, 29 propellers or engines. We could do the same thing. It's just a more complicated rulemaking process if we do that. Once again, we've not made any determinations to date, but we hope to get that started soon. But in the meantime, we got some help from the United States Congress. As part of the 2018 FAA reauthorization, which was approved October 5th, they had a Section 317 entitled Helicopter Fuel System Safety. Anybody on the working group, in fact, I'd say most of industry, especially manufacturers, knew this was a possibility, but it's statutory law. They actually I'll get into what they modified, but we, the FAA, aren't going to find compliance to a statutory law. We're going to find compliance to 27 and 29 and point out that these helicopters meet the statutory requirements. The U.S. public and Congress, basically, they've had a strong interest in post-crash fires. This recommendation only really mandated the fuel systems half of the equation, which, remember, is only in the order of 15% of fatalities. The real improvement in safety is seats and structures. The reauthorization law, it created a new section in 49 U.S. Code, paragraph 44737. That's similar to the Part 20, to basic law in the EASA world. It's different, though, but they created a mandate that says that no one can operate a covered rotorcraft in the U.S. airspace unless they're compliant to this set of rules. The list of rules, it turns out, is the same rules for fuel systems from the working group recommendations. And it reinforced that the FAA has the ability to do equivalent safety findings, usually called an ELOS, to those rules. We didn't want it to say you have to meet 27.952C. If somebody has another way of doing it that's equivalently safe, meets the safety intent, you want them to be able to do it. So we asked them to open it up a little bit and allow equivalent safety findings, which are used often in certification. And a covered rotorcraft, it's any aircraft manufactured after April 5th of 2020. So it covers, as written, everything but DOD. So that means experimental rotorcraft, primary category rotorcraft, any other special airworthiness, experimental aircraft, home-built aircraft. But the thing to remember is, they've implemented the working group recommendations, but this is a mandate on new manufacturing after April 5th of 2020. It is not it's not retroactive on existing rotorcraft. So they wrote it in statutory law, they used a few too many words to say it, and so it was, but it is definitely only intended and only applies on new manufacturing. Where did this all come from? The FAA created in 1994 Amendment 2730 and 2935 to the regulations, and that defines a fully crash-resistant fuel systems. That there's about five rules that were, well, like four modified and one added. 952 was added. So in addition to what the working group has recommended, which was a subset of those rules, somebody who's exceeded that mandate would also have be meeting the fuel tank load factor requirements. They have frangible, deformable fittings. Would meet the requirements for separation of fuel and ignition sources. There's fuel tank installation requirements and filler tank connection requirements. So the FAA, about a year ago, we put out an SAIB to identify all aircraft or all rotorcraft that are fully compliant to those rules from the Amendment 2735. And so that SAIB at the time, you know, it was a zero or a one. You either were non-compliant or you were fully compliant. We, being regulatory, that's the world we live in. Is you know, it meets it or it doesn't meet it. Well, after the congressional mandate, well, I'd say after the working group as well pointed out or has shown in their report that, you know, a system that's compliant to a partial set of the rules is extremely effective in post-crash fires and probably meeting parts of 960 or 562 and 561 for seats and surrounding structure, you know, it meets, you know, gets you a long way towards the safety goal. The original list actually had seven derivative models and STCs in addition to new helicopters. But with the congressional mandate, we've modified the SAIB. And actually, it says published November 27th. That's the date that I published it, but it didn't make it into the system until December 3rd. We actually have added another table to the link, which is aircraft that meet the subset of regulations in 49 U.S. Code 44737. It's a mouthful, but it sounds better than ROPWGA to me. And we also recognize that systems often exceed that minimum requirement, though it might not actually be fully compliant. So we actually show that in the SAIB. Give it a second. There we go. So it's a little bit small on this page, but I actually have about 50 printouts of the SAIB and these tables. This is table one. This is the table that was already in the SAIB link, and it shows all the models that are fully compliant to that set of rules, which is, you know, 952, 967, 973, 975, and 963. There's seven derivatives on here along with aircraft that were a completely new type certificate after 1989. This is the table we added, and you'll notice that there's a section called partial CRFS that meets the congressional mandate, and those are the columns in blue shaded here. And so we've identified with a star every subset of the rule, you know, A, B, C, D, or A, B, C, F, G, and then the material requirements and rollover valves. With the star, our intention here is that we wouldn't have any design that meets that. That's the minimum requirement. Remember, I said we lived in a world of zeros and ones. Well, we now have the congressional mandate, which gives us a pretty solid definition of minimum requirements. But we also recognize that a lot of those other rules that the working group didn't point out, and we didn't necessarily request that they mark them either. We're going to put a star in columns where that design has met additional requirements. The first one in that column is actually testing in surrounding structure and using, 370-pound puncture material, you know, meeting the full material requirements of the rule. And then other rules so if somebody actually met all those, if any of the new designs we're expecting in the next few months, to a year and a half to approve, meet this full set of rules, we'll add them to the table one of the SAIB. Remember, this is to identify to industry and not to operators, anybody who's actually interested, to be able to look and say, do I have a helicopter that meets the full set of rules, or there's a list of STCs. Right now, there's two STCs on the AS350. One, one that's more available for the aftermarket and one that's mostly for new production. Hopefully there will be additional STCs available or kits from the manufacturers as they bring them on board, bring other aircraft into compliance with either the minimum requirements or exceeding that mandate. So we're expecting the OEMs and aftermarket to be coming in with designs for fuel systems in the near future. At a minimum, we're already talking to a number of the, I'm sure I've talked to every OEM in the United States, and I'm sure EASA is having some conversations as well. Everyone's aware of this. The working group was represented by almost all of the primary manufacturers in the world. So they're very aware. A lot of people, there was a lot of influence, and a lot of these designs have been in work for a while. 18 months from the date that Congress said you can't deliver an aircraft with a certificate of airworthiness after April 5th of 2020, that's coming up soon, but most companies, I believe everybody, or I would hope everybody, is well on their way to those designs, even if they haven't made application. But as a minimum, they can meet the congressional mandate minimums. We can do equivalent levels of safety findings. But once again, the most complete solution is to meet the full set of rules from the amendment levels, 2730 to 2934 and 2935. Who's affected? The restrictions on operating in the U.S. airspace. So it doesn't say you can't deliver an aircraft, but you can deliver an aircraft, you just can't fly it in the United States. So effectively, the manufacturers are the ones to come up with the solutions for this. They effectively can't sell a new non-compliant design for U.S. operations. A U.S. manufacturer could export a non-compliant design, but they can't fly it in the U.S. airspace. So unless they really have a design that they only want to sell overseas, most likely they'll have a design that can be exported, with a fully compliant design. Foreign manufacturers, a lot of them are in the room here, you won't be able to sell an aircraft for operation or to a customer who wants to operate in U.S. airspace after April 5th of 2020. That date's coming up very, very soon. I mean, I've been in certification for 30 years, and now 16 months from now is tomorrow. I mean, that's the date they're rolling off the assembly line. Not only did Congress say that, I put it in quotes here, that the FAA would expedite certification and validation, we have every intention of expediting and certification and validation. So any concerns people have with equivalent level of safety issue papers, taking 12 months, they won't. Both the certification offices and the standards branch have every intention of expediting certification. When you get a congressional mandate, it rises to the top. That's it for now. But I do have a number of copies of the SAIB. I thought I had a link in here, but I don't. But the FAA website, a lot of people have already told me they saw it today. So a lot of people, you can go on RGL within the FAA system and sign up for notifications of rules, notifications of SAIBs. So, a lot of people have already seen this. But thanks again to EASA, and we look forward to working with you on this.